Good afternoon. Thank you for showing your support of education and educational leaders in the state of Kansas. We're very pleased that you're able to join us today. The struggle we all face is trying to schedule events when people are all over the country. We've done the best that we can. We know that there are many, many more people who would like to be here, but aren't able to make it today. So thank you for showing up. I'm Mike Hoke, Director of the Center for Research on Learning and co-sponsor of the Whelan, Kansas Leadership Award. Elizabeth Kozlewski, Chairperson of the Department of Special Education, is also co-sponsor. And Elizabeth is unable to attend today, but sends her regrets. She's meeting with federal officials from the Department of Education in Washington and assures me that she would much rather be here. The University of Kansas Department of Special Education and the Center for Research on Learning is very, very proud to make this award to some very deserving people in a school district. The award is for extraordinary leadership and the vigorous pursuit of opportunities for all students to learn, and we feel that this year's awardees exemplify that sense. The award is made in the honor of Dr. Richard Whelan, professor of education at KU, an administrator at KU for many, many years. Richard was a person who exemplified leadership in the extraordinary leadership that we are celebrating today. He did this in a profound manner throughout his career. But before we make this award, I've asked Deb Griswold if she would introduce the family and see if the family wanted to make any comments.
I'd like to introduce the family of Dr. Richard Whelan. First of all, Carol, his wife. And Mark, the son. Cheryl, daughter. And Craig, son-in-law. We want to thank you all for being here, and also for the wonderful time that we've had with your father and husband.
Now, before Jamie Basham makes the award, we've asked the Dean of the School of Education, Dr. Ginsburg, to share some thoughts about Richard and the impact he's had on education in Kansas and at the national level.
Thanks, Mike. In my office, there's this running, consistent commentary, and they always say, stick to the script. And knowing that, Rich Simpson wrote me a detailed several-page script to follow, which I intend to, of course, ignore. But no, I will follow it. But I want to start off by just saying that I've never had the honor of actually working with Dick while I was dean. He had retired prior to my coming here in 2005. But we did get the chance, both with Dick and Carol, to interact on a number of occasions. And I got to learn this. I got to learn through the many students and colleagues that he had worked with that he was a man of great integrity that had impacted our community in innumerable ways. And I learned, moreover, that he continued to work well after his retirement, right up until he passed away back in January. And I remember I would meet people from the districts that he was engaged in the metro area, and they would always just talk in glowing terms about him. So we're talking about a man who has dedicated his entire life and his career with the foremost thought of helping students in greatest need. And I think that defines Dick about as well as anything else. But let me give you the story behind the story, if you will. Again, Dick passed away, I think quite unexpectedly, in January 2015, a great loss for everybody, obviously the family, most so. Dick had been involved in the work since the 1950s. He had been a recreation therapist. He had been a child care worker. He had been a teacher. He'd been director of education at the Children's Division of the Menninger Clinic, Psychiatric Clinic in Topeka, and he had worked at the south of the school. And that was all prior to coming in the 1960s after leaving the Southwood School to KU to finish his, do his work on his PhD. When he finished, he had multiple opportunities around the country because Dick was at the forefront with a number of other people, many of them at KU, in defining the field that we now call special education. At KU, he directed our program in special education. He mentored numerous doctoral students, some perhaps sitting in this room, many around the country who defined fields, you would know their names. He was actually the dean of the school for an interim period, but wisely woke up and realized that's not a job any human should keep for a period of time. He was certainly a distinguished professor with us, emeritus professor, and he held the appointment of professor of education and pediatrics at the University of Kansas Medical Center. Through his work in public schools, through his work with local agencies, through his work at the state, he was a hearing officer, a compliance specialist, a mediator, and a trainer. He served in review panels for U.S. Department of Special Education and Rehabilitative Services. He was the director of the Division of Training and Programs at the Bureau of Education for the Handicapped for 2 years in 1972 to 1974. He was widely published, wrote many books. He was recognized as a leading national figure. But I think more important than anything else, he just touched people at every level in the education world. In many ways, he was one of our pioneers in the world of special education. And when people think of KU, they think of a lot of people, and Dick Whelan is certainly very, very high on that list. I'll sum up this way. I think without his ongoing and determined and unflagging commitment to the profession of special education, I don't think that the field would be what it is today. So we're all indebted to him for all the work that he's done over the years. But I think most important now, we're dedicated and thankful to the family for creating this great award to honor his legacy and to the honor of the great work that here in Lawrence this time around that continues what Dick started all those many years ago. So thank you all for being here. Thank you. And Jamie, I think you're up.
For those who don't know me, I'm Jamie Basham. I'm an associate professor in the Department of Special Education. When this award came out and we were asked to think about who we might nominate, a colleague and I, Kathleen Lane, who could not be here today, had no questions in our mind who we would nominate right away. We looked at each other from across the table and said, we should nominate. It was like one of those sort of instances. For the last few years, we've been working with Lawrence Public Schools on a number of the initiatives that they have. And we've done this in partnership. And this is important. The word partnership is very meaningful to how we have operated as a group, that we've worked with one another in us understanding their needs and having them understand what our needs are. It's been kind of a back and forth sort of relationship, and it's worked really, really well. And it's not only really worked well on one project, it's worked really well on a couple projects. And the vision that they've established for the district and how they operate from a leadership position on down through the teachers has been something that we think should be honored. And so when this came out, we said this is the perfect award for them. So I am here, and I have the great honor to actually be the person that hands out the awards here today. So I'm going to call all the folks from Lawrence Public up, Angelique, Terry, Ken, Leah. And so we've debated how to do this, and so there's a couple of things we're going to do here. The first thing is we just want to recognize that as a team and as a district, we're going to hand them the award. Give this to Angelique
Yep,
here.
Thank you.
But this is award, and it says the Whelan, Kansas Leadership Award, Lawrence Public Schools, for its vigorous pursuit and opportunities to learn for each student, every student. And it then says from the Department of Special Education and the Center for Research and Learning, University of Kansas, 2015. And I think it's just a wonderful opportunity that they could have this award and have it at their district office. And it's representative of all the work that has gone into the work throughout they're doing throughout their district. So congratulations. Then we also wanted to recognize the individual efforts throughout the district, because what you don't see from just their names being up here, and I don't know if they're going to talk about it, but they all hold different positions in their district. And this is something that we don't always see across districts, that we have a superintendent's office here through Angelique and Rick, who's not here today. And through their work in the superintendent's office, all the way through the teaching and learning office as a whole, in what we're doing with assessments and research, what we're doing with student special education, student services, and how everyone's working together for one vision for all students. And I think that's an amazing thing that should also be recognized. So each one of you also has an award that they get to take from the Angelique.
Thank you. Thank you.
And then we have Leah's. Obviously, we did not practice where to stand.
We did it by height.
Kevin. And we just want to, again, round of applause for what they're doing as a group, but also individually. Well, as part of this, if you want to, I don't know how you're going to present.
From here.
From here?
Yeah.
Okay, as part of this award, one of the things that we'd like to do is use this opportunity not only to reflect on what they've done, but also let them show and use it as a learning experience so that we can learn not only how to influence other districts, but as we can learn the lessons that they've learned and can reflect on what we're doing in our world. So we're asking them to do a presentation. I don't know what to say.
Sure. So we're going to share some information with you today. Come on over here so you can be sure and see the information that's up there. First of all, we'd like to say thank you for the award. We are very humbled and honored, and thank KU, the Department of Special Education, for the Whelan Leadership Award, and the Center for Research on Learning, in recognition of our work in providing quality instruction for all of our students through a system of supports, so CI3T, through implementation and expansion of our blended learning environments and personalized learning, but also our work in courageous conversations, and that's addressing our racial achievement gaps. So today's presentation is going to tell our story, and in those three areas specifically, what we want to do is just share a little bit of our journey that has occurred, and then the evolution, hopefully, that'll come through the story. So when we talk about the work we do in Lawrence Public Schools, while we only have four people here today, we want you to know that our successes are the result of hundreds of people. And that would include our dedicated building staff and principals, our committed Board of Education, and the work that occurs every day in our classrooms, as well as a teaching and learning team of over 50 people that are highly skilled. So again, this award represents the work of hundreds of people, not just the four individuals that are here today.
Okay, I had the pleasure of kind of walking you through, sort of our work along the multi-tiered system of support. So I'm super excited to tell you a little bit about that part of our journey. So meeting the needs of students, of all the students in our district, rather, has always obviously been a mission of ours through multi-tiered systems of support. And this kind of triangle and visual representation represents the start of our journey and the partnership that we have with Dr. Kathleen Lane and her team at KU. But through the years, we've always sort of had that, but it's looked different building to building. And so we were really searching for a more systematic approach, hence kind of this triangle. And we began that partnership when we, again, were working specifically with Dr. Lane and her team. And that sort of led to the development of a framework. This is the CI3T framework, Comprehensive Integrated Three-Tiered Model. And that partnership sort of began with a call we had from the state. Do you want me to speak to that?
Oh, thank you.
Great. We're going to be kind of going back and forth.
Okay, first of all, an award that I'm going to have to present, so I'm not sure where my name is Kevin Harrell, I'm the Director of Student Services and Special Education. Before I start, I wanted to say that I did know Dr. Whelan, and it was interesting because as a special ed director, when the compliance officer calls, you're not always excited. But I can tell you when I saw his name in an email or a message, I knew that this is going to be good, because I know he's looking out for the student, and he's not trying to get you, he's just trying to make sure you've done things right and trying to support you. So I would say he was an extraordinary man, I do believe that, so thanks. A couple of years ago, we got a call from the State Department of Education, Crystal Davis, in the TASM project, and she said, Kevin, I have an opportunity for you. Would you like for some of your elementary buildings to be in a cohort group to look at behavior and MTSS? And my response is no. And he said, we can't do some of our buildings. It has to be all or none. And she said, well, let me get back here to you on that. And when she called back, she said, you can be your own cohort. So what we decided to do was we took all 14 elementary schools and decided that we are going to, as a district, it's an all or none thing. All are in, and we're going to do it. There's no option not to do it. And our principals are excited because what we've understood is that we can do instruction, but when behaviors are interfering, you cannot do instruction. It interferes with instruction. So we jumped right on that, and they introduced us to Dr. Kathleen Lane and her project with the University of Arizona State. Sorry. which is a big thing, I do know. And we jumped on board, and it's amazing the things that we did. So I will let Leah talk about how we started that.
Thank you. So I was kind of referring to, and thank you for sort of the lead up to that, but our district vision and goals are really at the heart of what we do. So while this is where we began, we really wanted to embed this framework into the shared vision of our district. So we have kind of these three pillars that guide our work, which is excellence, academic excellence, equity for all, and then engagement of our community. So as we talk about this frame that we were building through this partnership, these pieces of our vision, these goals were intertwined all throughout that, which kind of led us to this new sort of frame. So you saw the one that we started with, and this is kind of through our work where we've ended up, and you see at the bottom those pieces, excellence, equity, and engagement, are what our frame rests on. So we're really excited that the CI3T framework reflects these goals. And before we discuss how this build looked, and we're going to let you hear from some of our stakeholders, I wanted to take just a second to let Angelique speak to briefly how in the area of equity and how we're closing the achievement gap, so that sort of piece and how that intertwines.
So when you take a look at this, you may recognize it as a compass, but it's actually one of our tools. The impetus for getting involved in our equity-focused goal was data that specifically showed our students of color were underperforming our white students, and that wasn't good. That didn't sit well with us. So we decided to get involved in some courageous conversations to start talking about culturally relevant teaching in our classrooms. But it started as a personal journey for our staff. Talking about race and having difficult conversations isn't easy. So we needed some tools and protocols. And the compass is one of the tools that we use in our district when we need to engage in difficult or courageous conversations about some topics that most people choose to walk away from.
The wonderful work that we do in the area of equity and closing the racial achievement gap has been a huge driving force as our buildings have built their MTSS CI3T system, and it's really threaded throughout our work. So it's nice that we started with that and know that as our buildings were building these plans and as we were building this frame as a district, we had that piece. So initially, when we began this work, as Kevin mentioned, in developing the systemic approach to a multi-tier systems of support, we were focused on behavior because that was something in our district we felt like we needed to begin with. But through the work, we really realized that we couldn't build a framework or a blueprint in isolation. We couldn't think about behavior on its own. We had to think about the whole system and how behavior impacts academics and academics impacts behavior. So we wanted our approach to behavior management to be just as instructional as what we do with academics. We wanted to be sure that we were looking at, you know, the whole child when we were thinking about our system and how we approach things. So our schools began the exciting work of building these sort of CI3T blueprints in a really integrated fashion. So we started, I think, in 2013, which is what Kevin mentioned, with all 14 of our elementaries. And then we did a bit of a scaffolded approach. We had our secondaries come on board the following year, and that was just to allow us the opportunity to better support all those buildings as we thought about bringing them aboard, building a blueprint, and really impacting what was happening in their buildings. So each building developed a representative team that had teachers, it had administrators, they still do, in fact, had, it's not in the past tense, and they have parent representatives, they have student representatives, so that all those individuals are weighing in on the work that they're doing and the types of things that are going into their blueprints when they think about the students in their building. So each of these teams went through a year-long, six-part professional learning series to assist them in building that blueprint that you just saw on the previous page. And it was kind of targeted. So they went through these six different parts, and in between each session, they had very specific responsibilities to go back and seek input from all the people in their system. So even custodians, bus drivers, teachers, anybody who's interacting with kids in the building had the opportunity to weigh in and kind of say, here are the things we think are important to include when we think about what do we expect of students in the area of behavior, what do we expect of students in the area of academics, and all these things that were, that we're implementing. So it was essential and continues to be essential that as those blueprints are created, as they're modified, as they're refined, that we continue to gather feedback. So that was sort of that initial training. Again, elementary did that first, and then that following year, when they were implementing, secondary was coming on board. So this is kind of gives you a sense of what that looked like. We wanted to show it to you because we're super proud of the work that those buildings have done. They created this primary plan, and basically they built in the responsibilities of students, teachers, parents, administrators for all these domains, academics, behavior, and social skills. So it's very transparent. Everybody in every building sort of knows what their role is in each of those areas. And then of course they're refining that with feedback as they get it from various individuals. So this is actually a specific example of Southwest Middle School's MTSS CI3T plans. You can sort of see all the work that went in, and again, each of those pieces and parts were informed by all people in their system. So it's pretty exciting. Right here, sort of where our standards are, our high quality instruction and the curriculum that we use that meets the needs in all those content areas. This, the behavior, those expectations are around the PBIS framework. So we use positive behavior intervention and supports, which is a frame as we think about how to share expectations and help kids know what they can do to be successful in the school setting. And then finally, we added the social skills component. So at middle schools, they have Connect with Kids, which is a curriculum to support them in delivering social skills at that level, and then positive action at elementary. So we have various videos throughout to kind of give you a sense. We told you we have hundreds of people in our system who impacted this, and we're super excited to be able to at least bring you some of them in this form. So we want you to hear from a few of our principals.
And the trainings that we attended were beyond helpful as we were looking at this insurmountable task of building and building-wide positive behavior intervention support systems. I wasn't sure how this process was going to work last year, and I thought it was going to be a lot of an additional thing to do. And really, more than anything, the CI3T process has been the framework that I hang all of the things I have to do on. So it hasn't been one more thing, it's been almost a guiding force behind how I can organize all of the things that we do every day for kids.
Well, my name is Bill Witt. I'm one of the assistant principals of Lawrence High School. We've been excited with our process, and I think one of the things we had to do as a school was remind our teachers that as we are putting our models together, was to remind the teachers that we want your input because this is your school as well. These are your expectations. This is a shared goal that we all want to help our kids be successful and learn, you know, positive behaviors and good expectations. But we wanted to remind them in the process that everything we've done up to this point is really, really good. You know, we're not reinventing the wheel. This isn't the golden ticket that's going to solve all the things. This is just a way to take everything we've already done and put it into a good model. And so I think that, you know, put the teachers at ease a little bit and really allow them to buy in.
This isn't the first time I've done a PBIS system. I've never done one that so involved the academic side of it, but it's been interesting to watch this completely different approach to implementation.
Our CI3T team has done, it's actually the biggest team I have in the building. There was that much interest in making this such a success. So they have really been the boots on the ground, talking to staff and working them through the challenges and, oh, have you thought about this? And it's been very nice to have that time with the team because they really are kind of me multiplied around the building to answer the questions that staff have about, oh, how do I connect a kid to the support? Or, oh, my screener data says this, what do I do with that? Or, oh, this ticket system doesn't really seem to work for this student, where do I go now?
Well, we have members from our special ed staff, we have a support staff member, classroom teachers, and we have a really good active parent member. You know, they really created the program. They are the ones that look at the data and review the program and survey results. They provide a lot of support to classroom teachers on their teams and other teams. They act as a sounding board because, you know, I don't always get all of the feedback as I'm the administrator, so that I think staff feels comfortable in providing them feedback. That teams are the kind of like the cheerleaders of the program, and I think that does make a difference. And we just happen to be fortunate to have a good team, and they're really true believers in it. So I think that helps.
So the work that they did, we can't commend enough. Those teams, as these principals kind of alluded to, really were the boots on the ground. And so the blueprints that those teams were building, and we're going to hear a little bit about another piece of that in a minute, they mimic that triangle that you saw initially. So we have those three domains, academics, behavior, and social. And you have the different tiers, you know, for students to move through. So we're constantly thinking about how that system meets their needs. So, oh, I do have the triangle. So here we have the validated core resource. Again, this is our academics, and a good example of that is this year we have adopted Reading Street as our K through 5 elementary ELA curriculum, English Language Arts. So basically, you know, we recently adopted that, and teams built into their blueprint the expectations for students, for parents, for administrators, for teachers in the implementation of that curriculum. So the blueprint sort of marries that right there and makes that process transparent. So whoever you are in the system, you have a sense of what is expected of me in terms of academics. Again, throughout the build, we were working on that social component piece, and as our elementaries and our secondaries were working through that, they kind of went, hey, we don't have a validated social skills curriculum. We aren't really doing anything explicitly to teach our students about social skills, so what could we do? And that's where they decided to adopt Connect with Kids at secondary and Positive Action at elementary, and now those all of our buildings have the opportunity to actively and very explicitly teach students those expectations. And then again, the PBIS framework, which falls kind of in the middle. The academic and the social components for us, the way we kind of talk and describe that is, it's the what you teach, and the behavior component's how you teach it, right? So it's how our teachers gain the instructional time to meet all the needs of the students. They're active in that area. So again, CI3T teams actively were soliciting that feedback to determine, you know, what their expectations were in terms of behavior in all the different various locations at a school where kids are and potentially having issues or not. So we are going to hear from a few people as well about sort of what CI3T, that PBIS portion looked like, what the rollout, and then how it's impacting.
My name is Kristen Ryan. I'm the principal at Southwest Middle School. And myself and my team have been planning and collaborating and problem solving all summer. We've really been talking about how we're gonna kick it off with our teachers and then kicking it off with our students. We're gonna really focus on the implementation manual and break that into different parts and have three different professional developments that teachers will rotate through, and team members will be meeting that PD. We've also spent some time planning out our back to school time with our students. So one thing that we're going to do is on that first day of school, is we're going to have the advisory teachers, once they've been through the PD, they're going to start going through pieces of the implementation manual, like the expectation matrix, explaining to students about the ticket, what they do with the ticket, how the student fills it out. And then we're going to kick it off with a large school assembly.
Well, my name is Bill Whelan, one of the assistant principals at Lawrence High School. I think teachers are finding out that pairing their praise with something tangible is very, very positive. And they're finding that it does feel good to give praise, and it does feel good to reinforce positive behaviors.
It's what we call best bucks. If your name's drawn for the Sunflower 500, we have 4 to 6 kids. They come down right after the morning announcements and they make a big deal out of it. And the kids come in and they line up and we race around our building's a circle, so they get to run as fast as they can around the building twice. We have a finish line.
One of our big gets is what we call a game day experience, because we're a large high school, very competitive league, and Friday night football games are very exciting on this campus. And so during our fall pep rally Thursday, we're going to draw 2 names, and those names each get to bring a friend, and we're going to give them the game day experience. So they're going to get special seating in the south end zone. They're going to get Pizza Shell, which is a local company that everybody loves, delivered to them during the game. We're going to give them concession passes and, of course, free admission.
As a previous high school and middle school administrator, it wasn't unusual in my last 8 years of administration to have students, unfortunately, in school suspension the first several days of school. And then we are really into the 4th week and slightly past that before we had our first major office referral. And I attribute a lot of that not to any kind of good luck in my 8th year of administration, but to a lot of the positive effects that we were doing in reinforcing the positive behaviors and, most importantly, setting good expectations at the classroom level, for the hallways, and for the other major settings. And yeah, I want to say we could count on one hand how many times our students have been in in-school suspension, or how many students have been in in-school suspension now that we're end of October since the beginning of the year. So I have really been having to rethink how many utilize our in-school suspension personnel. And so the positive and exciting thing for me is that I get to talk to him, have a conversation about pushing him into the classrooms to be able to work with students rather than supervising an in-school suspension environment. So really cool opportunity for us at South Middle School.
Those are just a few of the testimonies. We were super duper excited about that last one you were listening to. That's a prime example of buying back some of that instructional time through being able to really actively teach and then get that return. So excited about that. So just to move us on, as you all know, what mostly excites us about this framework and this blueprint is things are always coming into education, or they're resurfacing and they have a new name, or they're going out. There's all these different kinds of things coming in and out. And we feel like the blueprint and the framework that we have built helps us to organize all those things as they come in and out of our system, and gives us a frame by which to think about if it's something that we need or something that works. We can look at data, we can think of all the students in our system. So anytime there's a new practice, there's a new strategy, there's potentially a new program, we can explore it through the use of this frame that we've been creating, and it will continue to evolve, as Angelique alluded to at the beginning, but we're excited about that. We can ask questions like, is there data to support it? Is there actually a gap? Is there a need? Where does it fit in our system? We need it in one of those areas. So we're super excited. Our work is transparent. As I keep mentioning, it's informed by all the people in our system, parents, students, teachers. You know, anybody who interacts with our students has the opportunity to weigh in, and that's pretty exciting. So, I think what we're super excited about is the ability to meet the needs of all of our kids first in that sort of primary plan. We think about that triangle and that green area, but we know that there'll always be some kids who need more. So we've been kind of implementing some new systems. We have AIMSWeb, which is an academic screener. It's a way for us to look at math and look at reading and think about are these students exhibiting or showing us that they might need something a little bit more. We also started the SRSS, which is a behavior screener. We'll talk a little bit more about that. But all of those things help us to better inform how we can connect kids who might need a little bit more. So how we connect them to those supports, when you think about that triangle sort of along that direction. So we've begun to look at that type of data, behavioral data and academic data together, right? Instead of in isolation, we talked about that at the beginning. We don't want to just look at this student and maybe behavior concerns they're having. We want to think about everything. So that's been really exciting. Those screeners, the Ames Web, SRSS, and other types of data that we look at, qualitative and quantitative, help us to monitor what's happening at primary, and then also think about how to move students through those tiers, so that yellow and that red area. So we're going to hear from a few of our principals about what those screeners kind of feel like, because that was new for them.
I'm Lawrence High Principal Matt Brungart, and last year in the spring we used the screening instrument for the first time. We met with our department chairs and discussed what hour would be best and most consistent to do that. And we determined that we would use the second hour, and that was after basically just talking to the department chairs, having them go back and have a discussion with each department and kind of come into a consensus as a group. We feel the screening instrument, though, is going to give us a chance to get ahead of that. Really, what we've been kind of doing is the autopsy approach where the kid fails the class, how are we going to help them recover this. Hopefully now with this new data infusion, we're going to be able to go ahead and get ahead of this and get kids in and try and develop some measures to help them pass the course in the course, instead of figuring out how to recover the credit afterwards.
The behavior screening takes maybe 15 minutes at a staff meeting, and especially as the year has gone on, staff realize that there's no more value in spending an hour on it as there is in going with their initial assessment of about 15 minutes. And our Ames Web screens really have not taken that long. What's really taken us a more amount of time is just looking at them and saying, okay, what does this do for us? What does this tell us? But the initial investment of time is nothing compared to what people were anticipating it would be.
Our staff had pretty good experience with the map, and I think they did a really good job of taking a look at that, particularly around it. Looking at designing instruction for individual kids, but I think also now this year we're beginning to look at it more as an added benefit of what does that say about our tier one regular good quality first instruction, and making some decisions at a grade level about, you know, what do we need to do as a grade level different, and then the Ames Web I think it's going to help us a lot as we begin to add tier two and three interventions, academic interventions, and it'll help us focus those interventions better. I already see my staff using, and I didn't think they would, but taking the extra time to do the probes, and once they've done the screener part, then using those probes to measure kids' growth in progress monitor kids.
So because we are super data driven, we certainly couldn't do a presentation without sharing with you a little bit of what we're seeing, specifically related to that piece. So this is some comparative data from one of our elementaries. And so this is from the SRSS, the behavior screener. And you can see the fall 2014 data there on the left, and then the fall 2015 data on the right. And a significant growth of students that are falling into that green low risk category. So these actually aren't typical. These results aren't necessarily typical. You usually see a more substantial growth over a couple years of implementation, but we thought this was certainly worthy of celebration and speaks to the hard work that this building is doing in terms of teaching those social skills, teaching the behavior framework, and then reinforcing those things. So that's actually, this is internalizing. You can see the SRSS measures two things, students who internalize, those kinds of behaviors that you don't necessarily see as much, and then externalizing. They showed similar substantial growth in this area as well. So we really look forward, another thing that we're collecting is treatment integrity data, so the fidelity with which they're doing all these things. And what we're really excited about, and we do not have it yet, but we believe there we may find a connection between the fidelity with which they are implementing the PBIS component of their plan, with which they're teaching those social skills, and then this growth that we're seeing. So we'll start to look at that comparatively as we get some of that data in. This is our Ames Web, so we're starting to look at that academic data in a similar format. Just wanted to just show you some examples of what that looks like. So we want to be able to organize and review that data in a similar fashion for grade levels, for buildings, about individual students, and then part of our continued work that we are sort of in the trenches with right now is to build a system where teachers, individual teachers or principals can pull this kind of data up side by side by side by side. And so that we really are able to look at a student holistically instead of just some of those individual things. So finally, talk a little bit about the professional learning, and I kind of alluded to that in the beginning, but we've also built in some additional systems to support our staff. So they spent all this time, they went to all this, the six professional learning, they built their plan, and we can't just drop them off, you know, leave them be. We have to continue to support them. So they need that time to dialogue, and we know time is really hard to come by in education, particularly in these buildings. So we built in some time, and this is some pictures of half day session. We have five of them this year. For those CI3T teams who did that build, they get to come back five times for half days and they dialogue and they get in the trenches with data and they think about how should we share this back and what kinds of information do we still need from our staff? We need to hear more. This isn't working. This is working. And so this kind of allows them that time. So in addition to this, we have a lot of other professional learning systems, and we're about to move into a talk about how personalized learning and some of the other work and partnerships that we have with KU, how they are supporting that in primary plan, so how students are accessing content, so because we do want to try and get them all there first. So we have, as part of our professional learning plan, we also bring teachers and staff in for to learn about personalized learning, and in addition, we have a very explicit plan for our equity work as well. So we certainly are providing multiple opportunities for professional learning as teachers think about which part of that plan they're trying to enhance. So this piece, which is that primary curriculum we keep talking about, and it's available to all students just because they're there, right? Because they show up in our schools, they get access to all these things, all three of those areas. The circles don't like me. So, and aside from, I sort of keep mentioning the PBIS frame, aside from really supporting that frame in each classroom and each building, because we want to help buy as much instructional time for teachers as we can, we also support all kinds of instructional strategies, one of which is professional learning, and that supports across these domains and through the tiers. So, during the build of our CI3T framework, and actually prior to that, and similar to our equity work, our district has been continuously infusing technology into the classrooms and then providing professional learning around that, around a blended learning environment and personalized learning. So these efforts support our entire frame across and through. We're super excited. So we'll move in to that piece.
We want to share a little bit about our journey into personalized learning in our blended classrooms. And what I'm showing you are just a few pictures from our implementation. It started with a conversation in the fall of 2012, asking ourselves, how can we increase student engagement without just doing the things we've always been doing, just doing them more? Applying the same strategies, getting the same results. What can we do differently? What can we be innovative with? And can we get different results? So in the spring of 2013, we took eight classrooms and field tested K through 12, a blended learning environment where we infused technology, specifically 12 devices, but we went a little bit further and we started to modify the furniture because we didn't want practices to continue and just have some digital band-aids in the room. So we removed all of the singleton desks and brought in round tables. And you can imagine, as a teacher, now I have students facing each other. Are they going to talk? Are they going to be off task? Are they going to follow along? What does that look like? So questions just started pouring out during the field test, which was great for us because it helped guide our work and where we needed to provide more support. So you can see everything up here from the lower left is an AP physics class. The lower right is kindergarten. So we were field testing this across several areas, and in fact, I remember a certain dean of the School of Education having to suspend his disbelief after touring our kindergarten classrooms because we had five-year-olds logging in to our learning management system, and I heard about 19-year-olds not being able to do that. When you take a look at these environments, we're not talking about going completely digital. We're talking about an infusion of devices that help students access information. So paper still has its place. We're not going to be paperless. We just don't have to rely all on the paper.
You see a student sitting here working with the teacher, but the other two are progressing along in the content. So when we are personalizing learning, what you're going to move away from is the whole class lecture, the whole class delivery of content, everybody moving at the same pace, and more about personalizing it. If I need to move faster or a little bit slower, or I need to review content some more, the time is built in for that. Again, you can just see pictures from different environments. And as we moved across K through 12, we weren't seeing more success at one level or more success with a specific content area. We decided to start surveying our students, our staff, as well as our parents. So we survey our staff that are involved once every 6 weeks, our parents once a year, and our students every semester, because we need that anecdotal data back from them, because we were looking for response to that question, can we increase student engagement? This happens to be a shot out of one of our second grade classrooms. Talk about turning over the learning to the students. This is a little guy who's teaching how to add two-digit numbers. His peer is capturing it on an iPad, creating a video then that we'll place into our learning management system for any of his classmates that need to review that while the teacher continues her work with individual students. This is from one of our high school language arts classes. Again, that infusion of different furniture. When we introduced the, we call them cafe style, the high top tables, students just gravitated towards them and they felt like they were taking ownership of the classroom. It didn't feel like school anymore. One thing we learned very quickly is that we couldn't provide professional learning or support in the same fashion that we had been. So we don't bring staff in and then take them through a PowerPoint on blended learning and say, this is what it is. We blend the environment as well. We personalize the learning for the staff. This happens to be a summer session. Only 50 were required to come. You're looking at 95. The staff who are involved in implementing blended learning in their classrooms are eager to get in, to discover, to support, to reflect, and to learn from each other. This video that Kevin will start for us, while it was made by Blackboard, and that's our LMS that we use in the district, what it does is it highlights hearing from students, staff, and our parents about what blended learning is doing for them and how it's affecting their instruction.
So if you walked into my classroom, first of all, you would probably walk in before the bell rang, because students are eager to get started. You would definitely not want to be able to recognize the front of the classroom. There isn't one.
They have electronic devices out, whether they're iPads or laptops.
Students working on the computers through Blackboard. Sometimes it might be an individual student, sometimes they might be in partners.
Lots of conversation going on, collaboration, lots of discussion.
In a blended environment, it's a lot easier to interact with the teacher and work at your own pace and you learn how you want to learn.
I'm not busy at the front of the room being like, look at me, pay attention to me, and doing the lesson for 40 minutes and then I have 3 minutes to get to there.
I get to like multiply myself by 10 because I've put videos on there of myself explaining a concept.
Some of the choices she gives us are we can sing a song, we can do research and write it in a Word document, we can put a discussion up on Blackboard, and we can just tell it to her.
I like the idea there's videos and different ones for her to get activity so she can read it, or she can watch a video, she can read it over as much as often as she needs to, she can replay the video if she needs to.
She comes home just super excited and talking mild minute. Somebody would much rather sing a song than write a paper. Why not?
The student engagement is so high that they constantly want to get on Blackboard because they know that it's going to be an engaging and fun learning activity.
It's really cool because I love having all this technology there.
I had kids coming up to me the day we got access to Blackboard going, is there an app? Can I do the app on my phone? I found that most of my students were telling me that they had solved their own problems or that another student had explained something to them.
In math, I'm ahead of some people, so I help them with problems that they need.
My favorite is that there's no failure. You feel very successful.
If you grade it, if your grade was below something, you would be able to move on to the next journal entry, so you'd always be checking your grades online.
In a blended setting, I can hold students accountable for that relearning and
what I've found is that the students are interested in relearning and then approach me for opportunities to demonstrate what they've learned.
It's just created this sense of success, and the kids are very excited to come. I have someone come in at 7:30 in the morning, and school doesn't start till 8 or 5.
When I was homesick, I decided to log into Blackboard on discussions so that I could stay with my class.
When you can step out and just watch the kids work, either in unison or they're just so engaged that they lose all track of time, that to me is authentic engagement, and that's what we're producing in these classrooms.
I am more energized about teaching and more proud of what I do because of blended learning than I ever have been before. I know my students better. I know that they are 100% engaged from the minute they walk in the door until the minute they leave.
I like Blackboard and blended learning because they're fun.
So how do we get staff involved? I personally feel the success in our implementation has been because it wasn't demanded. It has been voluntary. However, we do have a very dedicated board who has shared with us that we want all of our classroom environments to implement this type of instructional strategy. So we have to put a plan in place, and we've talked about over the next 5 years. We are at about 300 classrooms now, which is almost 40% of our total classroom population. About 5 years to bring the rest on board. So we started with our early adopters. Those are your excitables. Those are the ones that are going to take it and roll their sleeves up and understand that this is hard work, but it's not going to stop them. They have the perseverance and the grit to work through some of the challenges. And we've had tears, teachers in tears going, I don't know how to do this. We didn't have a recipe. We just had to jump in and start trying out, you know, how many devices does it take, and what's the right number of tables, and how much professional development, how many times do we need to come together to really work and reflect. So we have an application process now, and this has evolved going into our fourth year, and we put that out there for staff. We know what our resources are, so we know how many we can bring on board, and staff who are interested apply to have this type of support and to become a district supported blended learning classroom to personalize learning. I have over 125 applications each year, and then we add about 65 or 70 based on our resources into our cadre. So we are continuing to move through. So the data is really important for us too, because we don't want to implement something without talking about a return on investment, because this is an investment by our community, by our board, and by our staff. As I mentioned earlier, we do survey our staff, our students, and our parents. And you can see for the engagement on the left-hand set of columns, even though our scale is increasing and we're almost at 300, what we're hearing from our teachers is that student engagement remains high. Continuously coming in as student engagement is still high. Discipline issues, referrals, like you heard from our building principals, that really becomes a moot point. On the right set of bar graphs, it's important for us to also measure the student achievement. So we can be engaged in class, but are the students learning? Are they reaching those outcomes that we've predetermined that they need? And you can see across from fall 2013 until spring 2015, that's coming back just as positive. It's continuing to increase. So great things are happening in our classrooms when we personalize learning. Just some survey feedback I wanted to share with you, the type of questions and what we're seeing from our teachers and students. I'm able to provide more immediate feedback to students in a blended learning environment. We thrive on feedback. All of us in this room enjoy immediate feedback. How did we do? Did they like it? Did they not like it? How did it taste? We like that feedback. This one was critical. Our teachers are sharing that blended learning has changed my approach to classroom teaching. And how wonderful to continue to enhance yourself as a professional practitioner and as an educator. You can see the agree off the charts. And we weren't anticipating teachers really shifting, like you heard from Paula in the video. This is a 33-year veteran in the profession. She said she feels like she's not ready to retire anymore, and she was right on that cusp of wanting to leave the profession after 30 years. Now she's ready to stay in it. So
I'm going to go ahead and turn it over to Kevin and Terry, who will talk about that partnership that we developed with the Center for Research on Learning in that technology-enhanced personalized learning environment.
Okay, my goal was not to talk today, but unfortunately I have to. What I will tell you is that we chose to have the videos with all these people because we clearly don't do it ourselves. And actually, I say that because as we move to this section, it seems like I was having a conversation with someone else, and I found some more work for someone else to do. And Leah really hates for me to have conversations with people because it seems like, okay, what am I going to do now? So what happened is I just happened to be having a conversation with Dr. James Basham about some of the things that he's been working in other states around personalized learning, some great things and some strategies that he's been using. And specifically about some strategies and students taking responsibility for their own learning. And that's really fascinating because as we talk about blended learning and our students, we really want them to be accountable to themselves and learn how to learn. It's not dependent on someone else to learn, learn how to learn. And I will tell you, and I believe this because I have a child and she was in the video, I have to tell you that. And she has learned how to learn. When she runs into problems, she knows how to get online and find something that tells her how to solve her problem and to play the video over and to find a way that she takes responsibility for her learning. And I think that's what we want for all of our children. And so in that conversation with Dr. Basham, we wanted to look at how we could do some of that stuff on our schools. And so Dr. Basham, myself, Terry, and a group study, I'll talk about what could happen.
So through that collaboration and partnership with Jamie Basham at KU, and we kind of came up with three teams of teachers from three different schools that would initially work with Dr. Basham and doctoral candidate Richard Carter to develop an understanding of an eventual implementation of specific strategies of technology-enabled personalized learning. Some of those strategies were things like self-monitoring, student self-monitoring and their tracking of progress. There's the student ownership of their learning, collaborating with other students to find help, accountability and self-motivation, the ability to articulate their own effort, which is a big deal, and the most important, grit. Teacher teams were able to meet with Dr. Basham and Mr. Carter during our regularly scheduled blended learning professional development times, as well as after school hours. From these initial three teams, we're hoping to expand this opportunity for additional blenders ongoing, and we're hoping that we're planning to partner with the Center for Research in sort of looking more deeply at our achievement data. But let's hear now from some of our teachers. This is a specific teacher team that was working with Dr. Basham last year.
Last year, we were able to work with Dr. Basham and Richard. They shared with us a whole presentation about the work that they've done going into other schools across the country and what made those blended learning environments successful. One of the areas that that they really talked about with us was the students' ability to self-reflect and to track where they are in the process, to know where the goal is, and to monitor that. Another thing that they talked about was how to monitor their actual assignments. And so we thought, well, if we could have a list of all the assignments or the things that they can choose to do, and all the different ways that they can do that, then we put it on one chart and then we can see exactly where the kids are.
If a student is, you know, maybe on lesson 9 and they see that other kids are on lesson 13 and they're in the green, they know that those are students that they can go to ask questions. That if I'm not available, I'll find one of those other people. And we've established that this is, you know, a collaborative environment, that
they're all teachers.
They're all teachers, and that they can all explain what they know.
In my class, we implemented lanyards that have, like, I'm ready to teach, so there's a teacher assistant, so I have those, and that way they can, you know, just kind of look around and see who's ready.
Started that, it took a lot of work with trying to help kids own their learning and realize when they didn't know something, that it's a smart thing to go ask questions, ask for help. key word that we talk about when we talk about monitoring our own effort. We talk about being persistent, having stamina, the quality of your work. And as we're going through this, we're coming up with other keywords as a team that all of our classes will go over. So that as you're monitoring your effort, it's not just simply how much am I in it today. Do I have stamina? Am I able to stay with this one assignment all the way through and still have quality of your work?
And the tracker also helps keep the kids accountable, because I have one student in particular that did not do a lot of homework. All of a sudden, about January, he decided I really need to start doing something. I need to go ahead and start doing this work. When I put a lot of effort into my homework, that makes my grades even better. And his level of maturity as far as I'm going to take responsibility, he doesn't care what anyone else in the class is doing. He goes over, does his assignment, comes and checks with me. He knows exactly the steps that he's supposed to do to be successful. I've not seen students grow like that before. Just to have absolute control of, this is what I want to do, this is what I want to accomplish, and this is how I'm going to do it. And to be successful, these are the things, these are some of the tools that I can use to be successful. You have all these kids that want to go in all these different directions, and you need to make sure that you're communicating with them, having the lessons ready to go, whether it's verbal or it's a video or if it's a small little snippet of something that you've done a reteach lesson on. All of that takes a lot of time, helping them get that responsibility, that ownership. And that needs to start with, it's huge.
And that level of independence where they can, even though it's hard, that they will still stick with it.
And they want that verbal permission, they want that contact. And then I have to let go of it too. So it's a challenge for the teachers, because we're all kind of redefining what we're doing.
It is interesting to see that shift from as they're going to more maybe a teacher role, because they're starting to do things like we learned some things on the iPad, and they're like,
hey, can I show a little lesson on here on how to round numbers?
Mm-hmm. Sure.
Sure, afterward.
So now I'll turn it over to Leah to wrap us up.
Thank you. And I have the pleasure of, I don't have it there. Yeah. I'm sort of wrapping this up for us. And in the true spirit of praise, when I sat down, one of my colleagues said to me, great job, Leah, you rocked it. Do you feel super great? I'm super excited. I said, yes, I do. I must have said that a lot, huh? But I am super excited. So anyway, thank you for indulging me. But our journey does continue, and it is an evolution. And we are excited, and we're hopeful, and we're inspired as a school district. As we continue our work, it feels, I think, more focused than it has been. It feels very innovative and exciting and transparent as we seek out all these different ways to get information. The CITT, sort of that MTSS, that multi-tiered blueprint that I keep referring to, has provided us with that base to continue our exploration of effective instructional strategies like personalized learning and like our equity work, and the kinds of things that help us access all those students and help them access our content. But ultimately, we can continue to explore those instructional practices to meet the needs of every single student who walks through our door, and that's super exciting to us, definitely. So, but our partnerships with KU, we keep alluding to those since we're talking about how those started, they're key to our success in starting out, establishing, refining, and reflecting on our systems. And we're thankful and grateful that we can sort of develop these questions that we have and reach out to right here in our community to individuals who are able to support us as we explore those questions and better our system. So thank you for that. We appreciate that. But as you guys know, often the important work that happens with leadership in education frequently goes unnoticed unless, of course, something's wrong. So we are, I think I speak on behalf of my colleagues when I say that we really appreciate the opportunity to be here and share with you a little bit of our work. And you know, we certainly credit these successful outcomes and implementation to our practitioners. And I wish they could all be here. I wish you could have heard from every single one of them. But they're the ones who are hard at work meeting the needs of all the students in our system. So they're actively accessing and utilizing all these systems that we've been talking to you about. So we really want to thank them as well. But we are excited. Thank you for the opportunity to share our work. And unless anybody else has anything to share, I think that's it for our presentation.
for you.
Clearly, the Lawrence Public Schools, its outstanding teachers, its district leadership team, exemplify the vigorous pursuit of opportunities to learn for all students, and we greatly appreciate all the work that you continue to do, and we value our partnership. Thank you so much. If you would like, we have a reception with some hors d'oeuvres next door and a cash bar, and be an opportunity for you to meet and mingle and ask questions of the awardees. Thank you so much.